నమస్కారం. డాక్టర్ బిఆర్ అంబేద్కర్ సార్వత్రిక విశ్వవిద్యాలయ విద్యార్థులకు స్వాగతం.
This is meant for the first year students of MA English. This discussion has relevance to your course 3 materials, English in India. This is a special reference to block 1 of the course. So, students, view the program carefully and make notes. I have with me two experts, Professor N. Krishnaswamy and Dr. Malathi Krishnan, to participate in the discussion. I am very glad to introduce Professor N. Krishnaswamy. Professor N. Krishnaswamy was Professor of English at the Department of Linguistics and Contemporary English in Central Institute of English and Foreign Languages, Hyderabad. He has taught for more than 30 years at the institute. He has number of publications and articles published in various journals. He has presented several papers at both national and international seminars and conferences. He is most renowned for his books like Modern Applied Linguistics, Politics of Indian English, English grammar usage. And he is also, most of our learners or most of you may be aware of him as the author of the course you are studying now. He is here to participate in the discussion, that is Macaulay's Minute. I am also very glad to introduce to you Dr. Malathi Krishnan. Dr. Malathi Krishnan teaches at Central Institute of English and Foreign Languages. She is Associate Professor of English. She has got a wide experience of 25 years of wide experience at teaching at various levels of institutions, right from junior colleges, polytechnic colleges, graduate and postgraduate colleges. She also guides research in English language education, especially in English for specific purposes. She is here to discuss Wood's Dispatch. Let us begin our discussion with a question to Professor N. Krishnaswamy. Sir, could you explain to us what was the controversy prevailing between the Orientalists and the Anglicists prior to the arrival of Macaulay in India?
Prior to the arrival of Macaulay in India, the issue was between the Orientalists and the Anglicists. Now, Orientalists will mean those who favored making use of our own classical languages like Arabic, Persian and Sanskrit for enriching the other vernacular languages, what they call vernacular languages like Hindi, Marathi, Telugu, Tamil and so on. The Anglicists, on the other hand, they wanted to make use of only English for enriching the vernaculars. So, one thing, there was an agreement between the Orientalists and the Anglicists. They all wanted Western knowledge and Western information. But in what language our vernaculars are to be enriched? Is it through English or through Sanskrit, Arabic and Persian? This was the controversy. There was a committee actually to plan out the educational policies before just Macaulay came into India. The committee consisted of 10 members. 5 of them favored our classical language, Indian classical languages, Sanskrit, Persian and Arabic. 5 of them favored only English. And in fact, even earlier, the Charter Act of 1813 allotted some money for enriching even vernacular Indian languages, but that money was not properly utilized. So, at that point of time, Lord Bentinck, who was the Governor General of India at that time, he wanted to resolve the controversy in favor of the Anglicists. It was actually a kind of a well-conceived of plan actually. He brought in Macaulay, and Macaulay was the chairman of this committee, and he had the casting vote. Ultimately, he said the whole thing will be in favor of English, and English will be the medium of instruction for enriching even the vernacular languages. Ultimately, the vernacular languages were not enriched, but English became the medium of instruction. This is the controversy between Anglicists and Orientalists.
What are the stated objectives of Macaulay's minutes?
See, Macaulay, when he came to India with a prejudiced mind. And during Macaulay's time, not only Macaulay, even some of his British rulers, contemporary British rulers at that time, they were all highly prejudiced against India, Indian languages and Indian culture. The one book they had read at that time was a book written by James Mill. James Mill published in 1817, the title of the book is The History of British India. James Mill himself was highly prejudiced against India. He had utter contempt for all Indian languages, Indian heritage, Indian culture, Indian traditions. He debunked all Indian intellectual and cultural tradition. That was the reference book for Macaulay and company. So after reading that book, Macaulay came to India to take over as the member of the Supreme Council. He came to India. And the kind of remark he makes about India, in fact, if you read them today, it is highly insulting. Let me just read out some choice abuses of Macaulay. He says, a single shelf of a good European library was worth the whole native literature of India and Arabia. The intrinsic superiority of Western literature is indeed fully admitted by those members of the committee who support the Oriental plan of education. He refers to the Orientalists. Even the Orientalists agree that Western literature is far superior to Indian literature, which nobody actually stated this. It's all his own thinking. In addition, he says, if we are to teach Indian systems of knowledge, the position will be as follows. Indian systems of knowledge are full of medical doctrines which would disgrace an English furrier. A furrier is a tailor, one who makes furs for garments. Would disgrace an English furrier, astronomy which would move laughter in girls at an English boarding school. Even English boarding school girls will laugh at our astronomy. History abounding with kings 30 feet high and reigns 30,000 years, and geography made up of seas of treacle and seas of butter. Treacle is the syrup, thick syrup that is made use of for purifying sugar. Something like our Amrit, let's say. That is made because our mythologies are full of milk, sea of milk and so on. He continues to say that this is very, very crucial. This is Macaulay's own wordings. If we are to teach false history, false astronomy, false medicine, because we find them in the company with false religion. So ultimately, his ulterior motive is to debunk all our systems of knowledge and also debunk our religion. In addition, he says, it is, I believe, no exaggeration to say that all the historical information which has been collected from all the books written in the Sanskrit language is less valuable than what might be found in the most paltry abridgments used at the preparatory schools in England. There can't be anything more insulting than this. Regarding the printing of books in Sanskrit and Arabic, he says public money should not be wasted on printing books which are less valuable than the paper on which they are printed while it was blank. Even blank paper is much more valuable than the ones on which these systems of knowledge are printed. So ultimately, he wanted to create, in his own words, we must at present do our best to form a class who may be interpreters between us and the millions whom we govern, a class of persons, Indian in blood and color, but English in taste, in opinions, in morals and intellect. In short, he wanted to create a class of English knowing bureaucrats, administrators, maybe lawyers, ICS officers in those days. He wanted to create a class of people who would rule the country for them, take the orders from the British rulers, and after all, it's a vast country, it has to be ruled. He wanted to create only that class of people. He was not actually interested in educating the Indian people or Indian masses. He never had any respect for Indian knowledge system or Indian tradition or Indian culture. This is the stated aim in Macaulay's Minute.
What are the hidden objectives of Macaulay's Minutes?
Oh, the hidden objectives, very clearly he states this in a letter that he wrote to his father in the very next year, 1836. He writes to his father, the effect of this education, that means English education, on the Hindus is prodigious. No Hindu who has ever received an English education ever remains sincerely attached to his religion. So that is one important aim. The second aim is to debunk our own character and make us dependent eternally on their own ideas for all our knowledge and on their own language for all even ideas to express our ideas. So it is making the entire nation dependent on their systems of knowledge and on their language. That was the basic aim. This was very clearly stated by a contemporary of Macaulay, by sweeping away all sources of pride and pleasure in their own mental efforts, that is in the Indians' mental efforts, we have to render a whole people dependent upon a remote and unknown country for all their ideas and for the very words in which to clothe them. That is what has happened ultimately. India has got the largest bureaucracy in the whole world now, and ultimately we have to depend, whether it is our knowledge of literature or knowledge of literary criticism or English language teaching or technology, we have to depend entirely on the Western world. Our entire knowledge is Eurocentric, Anglo-American centric, thanks to Macaulay. And Macaulay, if he comes back today, he will feel very happy. He will feel very happy because even today, the craze for English is more actually now. But one thing, you know, a minor thing that happened, I would like to mention this. During the struggle for independence, our own national leaders made use of English for a different purpose. They wanted to project India in English. We have forgotten all about that. So Macaulay's curriculum, which is given in the lesson, is still the curriculum that is followed in all our 300 and odd universities. So Macaulay immensely succeeded in his stated objectives and also in the hidden objectives.
So do you mean to say that Macaulay did not mention the word religion in the minute itself, but that was actually evident in the letter that was written to his father?
Yeah. Because after all, the policy at that time, the East India Company wanted to encourage missionaries actually. But the government of India, the government of England at that time, the parliament did not want to give an impression to the people of India they are going to encourage conversion and convert more people into Christianity. That was why they thought of the syllabus as a kind of secular syllabus. At the same time, there are Christian missionaries at that time. There were Christian missionaries like Alexander Duff and others. They did not like the secular syllabus, secular curriculum of the British government at that time. They wanted to introduce the Bible and the Pilgrim's Progress and other things. So they wanted to appear to be secular, but at the same time they wanted to encourage more and more of conversion. That's why later, even in the Woods Dispatch and all, the apparent secularism is maintained. But the hidden objective, for example, Charles Grant, who was actually a predecessor to Macaulay, he was known as the Christian director of the East India Company. And in those days, the English language itself was known as the Christian tongue. That was the position. So today, English is the global language. It is not attached to any culture or any religion. But in those days, in the first half of the 19th century, this was the impression. But the government was very, very careful at that time not to create that kind of an impression. So they wanted to make it very secular.
So the last question, sir, do you agree to the view that India was used as a trial ground for the introduction of English literature as a discipline before it was introduced in the UK itself?
It's a very important point. I am glad you are asking about it. English literature, as a result of Macaulay's Minute and then Wood's Dispatch, first of all, three universities were started in India, that too in 1857, old Madras, Bombay and Calcutta. The universities were started first. See, in the structure of the English education in India, first we start with the universities, with the ceiling first. And then as a kind of feeder ground for these universities, schools were started. And they totally ignored primary education. That is why today, even today, primary education is totally neglected. Secondary education to a large extent and the higher education to a great extent, they are fully developed. Now, in 1857, English literature was introduced in India. At that time in England, English was not a respectable language, because in England, the classical language was Greek. The language of religion was Latin. And because there were French rulers in England, the court language was French. So, Greek, Latin and French were the respectable languages. English was only a vernacular at that time. English was only a vernacular at that time. And in fact, even just universities like Oxford and Cambridge, they were not quite willing to introduce English literature at all. And English literature was introduced in the respectable universities in England. Oxford introduced it in 1894 and Cambridge only in 1911, 50 years after it was introduced in India. So, the Indian universities proved to be the trial ground for testing their own literature here. I would even go to the extent of saying that the canons of English literature were first developed on the basis of the trial run in India, in Indian universities. And once they were convinced Shakespeare and Romantic poetry, they were all canons of English literature, they were actually taken to England, introduced in British universities and again exported to the colonies. This was the position.
Thank you so much, sir, for your interesting talk. And now I would request Dr. Malathi Krishnan, and let me ask some questions to you, ma'am. With regard to Wood's Dispatch, a sequel to Macaulay's Minute, what was restated in the dispatch with regard to language policy that sought to dispel the fears of the native people?
I would like to get back to the minute, Macaulay's Minute again, and also start off this discussion by saying that Macaulay was here for a very brief period of time, just about 4 years, which included the crucial 1835 minute. Now, when Macaulay looked at it, he was looking at it primarily as an administrator. He had been assigned an administrative duty and he was fulfilling that duty. He was totally out of tune with the socio-cultural milieu of the country. He had nothing to do with the masses. He was an aristocrat in England itself, and he had that kind of overarching view of what the whole thing is. So,
he was loyal to his own cause.
He was loyal. Loyal to the British Empire. Yeah. And if you look at descriptions of Macaulay that you find in Britain itself, you would he's thought of now as Indians. We think of Macaulay as the originator of whatever is right or wrong with our educational system. But if you think of the British perspective, they consider him first as an essayist, a historian, and lastly as a politician, administrator, etc. Now, we have had this overemphasis given to Macaulay's Minute because that has laid the foundation for the whole system, I should say the way we are talking about it today itself originates in 1835. Perhaps, but for Macaulay, I wouldn't be talking in English at all. Coming back to Wood's dispatch, now it was in 1813, the first phase of English in India was a trading phase. And when it moved into 1813 period, and subsequently Macaulay's minute was 1835, the company moved into the field of education. And that is what we are concerned with now. Now, what did Wood's dispatch? Wood's dispatch came, 20, 30 years later, that is 1854. Now, this is when education in India started getting systematized, and perhaps it is an effect of Wood's dispatch that we have the system as it is still running today. Not much change since the origins of how the whole system of education got organized subsequent to Wood's dispatch. Now, what was the primary change? What was the primary shift from Macaulay to Wood? Now, Macaulay wanted a class of elite educated in English in order to run the bureaucracy. But when we move into this second phase where Wood comes into the picture, now vernacular languages were also considered to be suitable for the transmission, mind you, transmission of European knowledge. Now they felt, as rulers of the country, a dual kind of a loyalty. Whereas Macaulay, sir, as you said, was loyal to Britain, subsequently, when the rulers got established here, they also felt a kind of a social commitment to the country they were ruling over. So I think it's a very nice kind of statement. The ruling power had a sacred obligation to confer upon the natives the blessings, both moral and material, which would flow from the general diffusion of useful knowledge. And for them, useful knowledge was Western knowledge, was English knowledge, that kind of a thing. So now they move to say that all Indians cannot be, this knowledge cannot be transmitted to all Indians through English. So we'll develop the vernacular languages and see that vernacular languages can also become an effective medium of instruction. So that is where we had a kind of a saving grace, where vernacular languages were not allowed to die, but they were, although it did eventually lead to a kind of a class system between those who were educated in English and those who were educated in the vernacular. Well,
incidentally,
tense.
Even in Macaulay's minute, you have what is called the filtration theory. Yes. Macaulay ultimately wanted even this knowledge, European knowledge, to filter down to the masses. See, if you look at the language, to bestow upon the natives, this is imperialistic language actually. So to bestow upon the natives means as though they have all the monopoly over wisdom, and it has to be given to the, something is to be given to the natives of India. So that is why that filtration theory, I don't know whether they were sincere about it or only superficially said, the masses will have to be educated.
So Wood's dispatch in fact is trying to superficially set the imbalances of Macaulay's minute right. Macaulay's minute was very extremist, whereas Wood's dispatch is trying to tone down the whole thing and saying that perhaps we are doing something good for these poor people. That is the attitude that comes out through the whole thing. That is how vernacular languages also got a place in the educational system. Some attention started getting paid to it rather than ignoring them totally. But still, we must remember that vernacular mediums were not for, they felt that vernacular languages would get enriched through exposure to European literature. So that I think is very important. They didn't think that European literature would get enriched by exposure to Indian languages. So I think today we are confident enough to talk about all these things. But I suppose that too came because of Macaulay's minute.
Well, strangely enough, historically, it is the exposure to Sanskrit actually through Macmillan and William Jones and these people that ultimately gave birth to a discipline called linguistics.
That's right.
So it is the other way about.
Yes.
It is exposure to Sanskrit.
That's right.
Yes.
The Wood's dispatch, if you compare between Macaulay's minute and Wood's dispatch, Wood's dispatch gives paramount importance to primary education and expanding education to masses. In the case of Macaulay, it is only confined to the elite and then to the higher education. Would you comment on it, please?
You're right in a way, because Macaulay's objective was very different. As I said, they moved into a later phase with Woods Dispatch. But Macaulay was primarily concerned with manning the government because they couldn't get that many Britishers to come into India to work as clerks over here. The easier alternative was to get a group of Indians, and these were Indians of the highest class who were already educated in the Indian languages, Arabic, Persian, Sanskrit, etc., which were the court languages. And so they found that these people were of a high intellectual caliber, and therefore they could pick up English, and they could be now relative to the British hierarchy, they were in a very inferior position. But among the Indian classes, they were at the highest level. So this was a kind of manipulative strategy that they had developed with no concern for the general upliftment through education of society at large. But with Wood's Dispatch, as I said, they were moving into a phase where they also tried to show a concern for the upliftment of the general, the masses through education. And that is where they felt that it is not just the university level or the higher education level that needed to be paid attention to, but also the primary levels. But they did a very, very superficial kind of service to this. And I think that out of that grew our own attitudes towards primary education. I think it's only in the last 10, 15 years that we are going at it with a war footing. This should have been done in the 1950s as soon as we got our independence. At that time, again, we were prevaricating between whether we should have vernacular languages as our medium of instruction, the national spirit, nationalist spirit. And today with globalization, what has happened? The demand for English has come from the lower levels itself. So it's all to do with what has gone through the evolutionary phase of language, the language of English itself in the world. So they were our rulers incidentally, but then the language has also had its own growth outside the parameters of Indian perspective. So I think one of the contributions made by Wood's Dispatch was to think of school education and primary level education.
I suggested actually a mechanism for the grant in aid mechanism.
Yeah, that's the next thing that Wood's Dispatch, most important thing I should say, about how education need not be a totally government policy, that other bodies should also enter the fray. There could be private agencies, and missionaries were active in a large way during that period. And the missionaries also felt that if government aid was withdrawn from them, then they had to look for financial sustenance elsewhere. But then this also made possible of a kind of a decontrol system of the whole of the education being in the hands of the government, and how a few government schools, now government aided schools in today's parlance, is that is what it is, how the government can support certain institutions, but the major, the entire demands of the country cannot be met by the government support alone. And so this whole system of grants in aid, which started then and which is in existence even today, is that is how it came about, with the government funding certain institutions where it found that it was necessary, and leaving other sectors to be taken over by private agencies, wealthy Indians who could support it, or the most common thing that was available then was the missionary institutions. So this was the second major recommendation of the Wood's Dispatch.
Maa karyakramalapai mee soochanalu salahalu telicheyandi. మీ సూచనలు సలహాలు తెలియజేయవలసిన మా చిరునామా డైరెక్టర్ ఆడియో విజువల్ ప్రొడక్షన్ అండ్ రీసెర్చ్ సెంటర్ డాక్టర్ బిఆర్ అంబేద్కర్ ఓపెన్ యూనివర్సిటీ ప్రొఫెసర్ జి రామరెడ్డి మార్క్ రోడ్ నంబర్ 46 జూబ్లీ హిల్స్ హైదరాబాద్ 500303